Welcome back to the Sidetracked Podcast, Episode 2. Today we enter the worlds of junkies and get high. All right, welcome back, guys. Thanks for tuning in. Jason's playing Star Wars right now.
It's on autopilot. I'm not really playing it. So, you sent me, how did this topic come up? You sent me a video, right?
Yeah.
Or did you just make a statement?
I made a statement, but I was watching, the video came up on my Facebook feed, and it was a couple holding hands, and like, then he like, she jumps off the side of a building, and he holds her hand and like dangles her and swings her back and forth, and then she climbs up on the building, and then they start doing somersaults, and they drove a hover, what are those things called?
Hoverboard?
Hoverboard, thank you. They're not really hoverboard. Two wheelies.
The electric thing.
On the side of a building. It's basically like an electric coming to a
without a handle.
Yeah, they're coming to an abrupt stop right at the edge. Ah! And I sent you a thing. I was like, this thing pisses me off. It infuriates me that people do this. Because to me, they're adrenaline junkies, right?
Yeah.
And to me, they are just putting their life at risk for what?
Yeah. And that's where it came, I guess the topic came from, is that he was like, this drives me crazy. And I'm like, it's the same thing as skydiving. Really? There's an inherent risk. Although I would say skydiving is less inherent risk, yeah. But you run the risk of pancaking yourself anytime you jump out of a plane.
Yeah.
Right. You just do. It's just a part of doing that thing. Bungee jumping, something could go wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Other things that
skiing,
people do.
Skiing, snowboarding.
Sure. Yeah, people break their neck and die. People Sonny Bono themselves. I'm trying to think of a thing to call each one of these things. Yeah, it's risky, and you get a reward from that risk.
But this is like, there's no safety involved.
I mean, there's no safety involved in downhill skiing. As if you
helmet. Like,
I mean, not a lot of people wear helmets.
Well,
some
their
people
own
do.
Fault, is it?
Right, but that's what I'm saying.
My
if
thing
you're likening
is
likening it to that.
My thing is that you're hanging off a building and hanging from a crane, like
yeah,
it is.
Those are the worst.
It is
ones.
Life and oh yeah, watching
there are
those
people
videos.
There are people that climb like to the tippy tops of like sketchy foreign buildings,
yeah,
like ones that are built too high anyway. And right. They'll just climb to the top of them and be hanging off like this spire at the very top of the thing.
And
it's terrifying.
And you're getting out of this is that instantaneous rush.
Yeah.
Like, holy cow.
And a selfie.
I'm about to die. And a selfie.
I feel like we should have looked a little bit more up about that. I think people have died doing it.
Oh, yeah.
For selfies,
oh, yeah, yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Which is a commentary on our culture, I suppose.
What?
The fact that people are dying doing something for a picture of themselves.
Well, do you think?
I guess that's what people who do Mount Everest do.
These adrenaline junkies didn't just come around with the invention of the selfie stick.
No.
They've always been around. I guarantee if you go back to when the Empire State was being built and you had people fucking climbing up there and hanging off the edge. And I can't imagine it's just a new creation.
No, I mean, I'd imagine things like bullfighting and whatever linked into that gladiator stuff. I mean, gladiator stuff was a little different because people were being forced to do it. But I'm sure the people who won got that.
That adrenaline.
Mm-hmm. Wrestling, all of those. I'm trying to think backwards about things people did. And I suppose wrestling gives you that same adrenaline rush and reward circuit.
You're
defeating someone.
Oh, no.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, I guess, but you're not inherently putting your life at risk.
I suppose not for wrestling.
We're climbing on a building. It's one small move and you're dead.
But it's the same.
Your hand slips and you're dead.
It may be a similar adrenaline rush, is the thing.
Then why not do those things? Like, I don't understand. I cannot comprehend someone just willingly throwing away their life like that.
Well, it's the difference between being competitive and needing the thing that's giving you.
And that seems like that's the quickest way for them to get that rush, right? It's the junkie mentality. How can I get that adrenaline the quickest? And if they want the adrenaline and they're not willing to put in the time or effort, like through sports or maybe parachuting isn't enough, I don't know, the training to do that, then they're, I'll just hang off a belly and I'll feel that quick rush. Oh, that felt good.
Yeah, I don't know. It just, it seems so similar to other things that you can do that are less terrifying.
Yeah. I don't know if if the greater the danger, the more of a rush you get. Maybe. I'm assuming so.
Well, yeah. I mean, that would make sense.
Yeah.
That part would make sense.
I don't know. I don't get what the rush is about, it seems
rebellious, is all. It's like, because I'm sure that they get a very similar thing from jumping out of a plane, but jumping out of a plane costs money. It costs lots of time training to do it by yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And you can just climb up a building and hang off of it for nothing.
You know, and this is kind of along the lines I view it, is the wingsuit guys.
Yes, those are watching super interesting.
Those and people
super
like,
terrifying.
Oh yeah, you've seen the videos where like
they're touching the cave wall, canyon walls or like treetops and stuff.
And they're just skimming by
and it's like if there was a big gust of wind, you would be a splatter on something.
Oh yeah. And they have parachutes as if it's them spinning out of control, they'll just launch their parachute and it'll save their life.
Not quite. It would super kill you.
Yeah.
So I guess my thing is, why do it at all? Because I'm telling you right now, nothing in the world is going to get me to jump out of a plane. I just don't. Mm-hmm. I don't care for any. None of that is worth the risk of jumping out of a plane.
I'm terrified of heights, right? Terrified.
Sure.
But my friends went skydiving last year, and I was like, now I kind of want to add it to my bucket list.
Really?
Like to try it. Yeah,
I have
absolutely.
No desire to bungee jump. I have no desire to...
Bungee jump.
No desire to skydive. None of it.
I don't know. Something about skydiving. I don't have like...
You just want a dude strapped to your back?
So my fear of heights is actually like watching that video. Those videos, those people, and like seeing the edge. That gets me dizzy. And then actually standing on the ground and looking up. Looking up at like tall buildings.
Oh, like at a building.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like looking, that gets me nauseous and dizzy. And
that doesn't bother, the looking up doesn't bother me. And honestly, the looking down doesn't really bother me either.
That bothers me too.
The problem is that I worry about losing my glasses. When I was younger and I didn't have glasses, like the looking down thing didn't bother me. And now I think it's just a response to being like, I don't want to have to rebuy these glasses. Like I think that I'm inherently not afraid of heights, but
I
just
can't.
Like, oh no.
We went, a bunch of friends of mine went to the Adirondacks and like we went to Mount Marcy, the highest peak in New York. And it's fine. Like, I can do the trail. And then as soon as you get to the top, it's just bald. It's flat. Like, you can see out. And then you get to the very top, which I couldn't do because where we got to, where it opens up, it was just rocks and boulders. And you had to climb straight up. And I get dizzy. And I just
can't.
I have to stay away from the edge. So whenever we get to mountaintops, I can't. Either I can't go to the very top because it's just too barren and too small. Mm-hmm. Or I have to sit in the dead center and look straight out or straight down. Because if I look just enough down, I'd see here's the edge and here's the drop. And then I get dizzy and sick. And
so if you get dizzy, is the risk that you think that you're going to fall because you're so dizzy?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
But see, I don't...
I've never been so dizzy that I would fall. And maybe that's just an irrational fear that your body's like, don't do that.
But that fear, like, that's the same fear these guys are trying to get. And that's nothing I want to
have. It's not pleasant.
So I don't understand. Yeah. To come back around, I don't understand why they're seeking that.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess it's the same thing as people who drive their car real fast and do other things like that. Like, yeah, if you drive your car 120 miles an hour, like, there's a good chance that if you crash, you're dead.
Yeah.
In a regular car. Obviously, there are cars built to have you not die if you crash them at that speed. But just like the average person's car, you would be just a stain.
Yeah.
If you crash them going that fast. And I don't do that either. Like, I guess I just don't. None of that stuff appeals to me at all.
And I want to know why it appeals to people. I just can't comprehend it. Why throwing your life? Like, you can.
And
get
it may just be that same addict mentality where I feel like
anything can be made a drug.
Yeah, and drug addiction is a disease, mm-hmm. right? So there are people who are more susceptible to needing that release of endorphins or whatever that specific thing releases
yeah.
than others. I don't do heroin, but there are lots of people who do. and it's not because they're like, oh, I really want to die.
Yeah.
It's because it releases something in them that's like, this is the best thing on the planet. And it's the same. It's probably the same exact thing where it's like, okay, well, I'm not hanging off a building. I don't have a death wish.
Yeah.
But if someone does that once and they're like, oh my God, this is the best thing in the world because of the chemicals it's releasing in your brain, it's probably the exact same thing. And so you just keep doing it.
And that's why when they get off it, they just replace it yeah. with something else.
You see YouTube videos of people doing this 1,000 times a year.
You are crushing this table today.
It's because it's so small. But there are people, like, it's like compilations of people who do this not every day, but often.
Oh, often, yeah.
And it's like, oh, you might be actually addicted to that chemical.
That's what that seems like. When you're rolling and like just timing it so your feet hang off, you're like, oh.
Yeah, that's sketchy. As much as I don't like the ones where people are like hanging by one arm, looking like straight down at like certain death, that is scarier because they're so confident. I guess they're both the same.
Yeah.
They're so confident in the fact that they're not going to fall. And I'm like, I'm not confident you're not going to fall. I think you might die.
Actually,
the only reason I don't think you're going to die is because I'm looking at it on the internet right now on mm-hmm. YouTube and not somewhere weirder on the internet showing you die.
Yeah.
Crazy.
The only way of confidence. You're on YouTube. That's
yeah, that means
live.
That means that you didn't fall to your death probably. So I'm pretty sure you're going to live. But it like makes me like people get like the selfie stick up on the top of something and like spin around and I'm just like, nope, I'm gonna throw up just watching you do that.
Can't do it. Can't.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of that. But an interesting thing, I was talking to my wife. My wife is an addiction counselor by trade.
She should put her 2 cents in when we.
And she talked about how the same chemicals that get released when you are doing drugs like heroin or opiates or whatever else is the same thing that gets released when you, it's like tied to a really old response center that's mm-hmm. like when you vanquish an enemy or you defeat someone or like if you, it's like hunting,
everything
and whatever
goes back
else.
To caveman days.
It really does. Because it's like, oh, I won, I beat this thing and now I get to eat it.
Yeah,
for animals, not people. But and then you get back to whatever else, and it's tied to that same thing.
Yeah,
and it's posited that that's the same reason why people like sports so much, why people get so invested in sports. So you have a team, you Michael. What is your favorite basketball team?
Chicago Bulls.
The Chicago Bulls. Why do you like the Chicago Bulls? I mean, it doesn't give you anything now, but you initially liked them when you were little.
They're a disappointment, though. All my teams are a disappointment.
Yes.
The Bulls.
So, Michael likes the Bulls. Michael mm-hmm. liked the Bulls, presumably, the same reason that everyone liked the Bulls. The Bulls were amazing.
Yep.
And you watched them just stomp people, and it was awesome. Michael Jordan was amazing. Michael's named after Michael Jordan. But you get something out of that.
Yeah.
You get a feeling when your team wins.
Yep.
And then you tie yourself to that, right? So when I was little, I lived in Cleveland, but I really liked the Cleveland Indians. And like in 97? They went to the World Series. And I don't know if I still like them, because I don't live in Ohio anymore.
Yeah.
But my favorite team, like I still like the Cavs, I still like the Indians. The Cavs were awful my whole childhood.
Yes.
And then got good recently. And I think that's partially because I was too stubborn to give up on them. But the Indians, I don't know if I was like, oh, because I could have been a Yankees fan or something. Like the Yankees were amazing when I moved here.
Yep.
From there. But I was like, no, the Indians. And I wonder if it's because like at such a young age, I was like, oh, I saw them go to the World Series and it was awesome.
Yeah, I don't know. Because so like we're both Buffalo Bills fans.
Which is unfortunate, yes.
Yes. We saw them go to the Super Bowl, but we saw them lose.
It was also, we were both.
Yeah, we were also, yeah, really young when they went to.
Like 6 years old.
Yeah. So we've never seen them win a playoff game.
No. No. We saw them in the playoffs, but lose.
In the playoffs, but lose.
It's true.
Because, like, my most recent playoff memory of the Buffalo Bills is Music City Miracle.
2001?
Yeah. And they went to the playoffs in 99, I think. And they went to the playoffs a couple years after that, before that as well. But I don't remember that. I just remember them getting...
That's like Wade Phillips.
Yeah,
right? That's
correct.
The time that
so,
went, which is a long time ago.
So how do... If that drive for that rush is there, then why do people stay fans of a team? It, and I think does that, it increase the longer you wait for that, that?
I mean, can you imagine being a Cubs fan? Let's go back to that.
Oh, yeah.
There are Cubs fans that waited 100. Well, they probably didn't wait.
No, well, there was that
old, the oldest person.
Yeah,
was like 100 something.
Yeah.
That waited that long. And so is it that much sweeter to have waited 100 years for something to happen?
I don't want to wait 100 years.
At that time, the thing is that even though they weren't champions,
yeah,
right? You still get that when they win games.
I guess.
Right? But because it's micro versus macro when you're looking at it, right? Because it's like, all right, every time the Bills win a game, you feel really good. Every time they lose, you feel really bad.
Mm-hmm.
If they won the Super Bowl, you'd feel really, really good. But that doesn't take away from the fact that people who enjoy sports, like even the Jaguars, get a couple of those rushes a year. You know, people who like the Jacksonville Jaguars, yeah, or whoever else is terrible right now.
Suck for those 0-16.
Yeah.
Lions.
Yeah, they get nothing. And then nobody's a fan. They're like, you got us nowhere all yeah. year.
No rush from
yeah.
you.
Yeah. So I don't know.
I
think that's why bandwagon fans exist, though. Because what's the point of.
Yeah, you hear that.
Like, I'm all right. So if I all of a sudden, you know, someone was a Bulls fan their whole life, right?
Yeah.
And now they like they're like, oh, but the Warriors are
so
really good.
So
why would you do that? You want to watch a team win, right?
Yeah.
That's the idea of a bandwagon fan. They jump on whoever is hot at the time. I feel like the psychological reason for that comes back to what we were talking about.
I'm wondering, it can't be as good of a rush as if you stuck with something, right? Like,
I don't know.
Like getting that hard, and we say hard earned, like
yeah.
we're on the court,
yeah,
but
exactly.
like sticking.
That's just like people who, and I'm guilty of it, who say like when you're talking about sports teams.
We need to cut the coach.
Yes.
We need to
yeah.
draft a court. Yeah.
yeah.
No. So is sticking with it and like the thick and thin, it has mm-hmm. to be a greater euphoria at the end of the road once you get there, then versus someone that's like, oh, I'm a Warriors fan. Ooh, I'm a Cavs fan. Ooh, I'm a
yeah.
Warriors fan again.
I guess it all comes down to your personality, I would imagine, more so than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because some people don't care. They'll take a win no matter what they can do. It's the same people who like cheat at stuff. It's like they don't care if they have to earn it. They can, if they can get it with minimal effort, they'll do
all
that.
All bandwagon fans are cheaters.
Cheaters. Just, I would imagine that's the same thing.
Correlation is causality?
Yes.
Yes.
That's funny. So I'm going to get sidetracked for a second.
That's
here.
Fine.
So the correlation is not causation thing.
Yeah.
Is actually, it was like the first thing that when we started
we
thinking about doing
do.
This, we were like, that would be really funny to
damn
talk about.
Show that I will not speak of did it. And then we kind mm-hmm. of, we trashed the idea because we didn't want to copy it.
Yeah. But that was like the first thing that
we
were like, oh, that would be really funny to talk about. We could talk about that. How could we talk about that? And then we were like, that's like where this whole thing spun from.
Yeah, that's right.
Was from that specific conversation.
And then we never even did it.
And then we never did it. But it's just funny. It's funny that came up. Correlation and causation.
It's applicable to everything.
Yeah. You're going to make it?
Yeah. Got chest pain.
It looked like you got stabbed.
Well, not chest pain. Lower rib.
Lower rib cage pain. Lower right anterior rib cage contusion.
We got to talk. So, two things I've been watching. And
yes.
You've sidetracked me so much, and it'll be real quick.
That's fine. I'm pretty sure we're done with the regular thing, but we have
yeah.
some time.
Yeah. So, there's two things that I sidetracked that we got to talk about in
okay.
the future. First of all, so Dan Buckley, name drop. Now he has to put his sticker on his truck.
Yeah, we have sidetrack stickers. Some of you have probably seen them. Some of you probably haven't.
Sidetracked.
Sidetracked. So we're going to, if we use people's ideas for stuff, we're probably just going to send you a sticker or whatever.
But so we were going to play a game. We're going to hang out and drink. And he goes, last Saturday, he goes, oh, I can't, I'm busy. And you go, okay. What are you doing? The season premiere of Planet Earth 2 is on and I don't want to miss it. So ridiculed him for weeks, right? Made fun of him constantly. Planet Earth 2. Yeah, I'm like, DVR. He's like, I don't have a DVR. I'm like, watch it. It'll be on again. He's like, but I want to watch it live. I'm like, it's not live. It's recorded.
The internet's full of Planet Earth.
So we ended up not doing anything because of Planet Earth 2. So I watched it yesterday. I'm on his side. It was amazing.
Okay.
It was well worth it. And the shit you see in there, talk about adrenaline junkies. It was about like goats on the mountains.
Yeah.
And
how they hop from like tiny rock to tiny rock on things that are this steep.
Yeah. And they go, their hooves have the most grip of anything. And it's how, I don't understand how this has grip and it just sits flat like this. And they're like, sideways, like walking on walls. It's amazing.
Well, it's probably the same thing spiders and other things have where you're like, I don't know why you can do that. Squirrel, how do you do that?
Yeah, it was amazing. So check it out. That's not the thing I want to talk about.
Really? Yeah. You got very sidetracked for something you didn't want to talk about.
Because it was this weekend. I was watching two things. The second thing I was watching is Destination Channel turned into like ghost paranormal channel because everything they do
is Destination Channel?
It's like the Travel Channel. It's like Travel Channel's sister network station, whatever.
Didn't know that even existed. So the fact that it changed to something else was not
for like the past 2 weeks. It was haunted house, paranormal investigation, a paranormal lockdown, paranormal activity. Just not.
So they're like 5 years behind the Discovery Channel because that's what they do.
Correct. Sci-fi channel. Yeah. So they've been doing it, and the thing we have to talk. I think that'd be an interesting thing to talk about. One, you look like you don't even believe in ghosts.
I don't believe this.
But I find it really interesting. And like they also talked about like exorcism and things like that and blessing of houses. And it's a really interesting thing to look up because every culture does it. It's not like a Christian thing. But I find it funny that people go to priests in the United States. But if you're in the Middle East, you go to, I don't know the equivalent, but of an Islamic priest,
but whatever that
they
is,
come and bless your house as well. I'm wondering, one, if it's a pseudo or what is the placebo effect, right? Could I take an Islamic priest, bring him here, and do the same thing, and would you have that same feeling of comfort? It's interesting.
See, I got a radon detection in my house, and that made me feel safer. So. Maybe that's the same thing. I'm pretty sure there's no toxic gas leaking into my house.
Are you safe for that? But yeah, it was interesting.
That is interesting.
Next week, I'll have a haircut. Next time you guys see me, I'll have my head shaved.
Your side head's shaved.
My side head's shaved. It's getting insane. And my beard shaved.
Trim.
Shaved.
Not shaved?
Well, it's going to be...
Like zooped?
We're gonna
zooped all the way off?
I'm trying to ZZ Top this beard, man. But I do not have the finesse and skill because every time I try trimming, I...
Too far. One side and then too far to even. Yeah.
And then I just shave it off and start over. So I'm
going to... Your beard grows out.
Yes.
As just opposed
like,
to ZZ
just like
Top.
My hair grows out. Like my hair. If grows you look out at also. Photos of me, fro. Yep. Huge fro. So my beard apparently froze too. So I'm going to get it professionally done.
I want to talk, not today, but another thing we want to
talk
about.
So many topics.
Yeah. Well, this is what we're going to do. We're basically going to listen to the end of all of our own episodes to figure out what we're going to do.
Because we don't write them down. We come up with good ideas and we don't write them down because it's our own fault.
Yeah.
So
it's stupid.
You get to listen to our ideas.
But
now.
Brian Francotti.
I'm not doing.
Name drop. No, not that. Okay. Not that. Brian's going to, if Brian listens to this whole thing, he's going to be so upset that we didn't even say it.
Yeah.
But he got me to read a few of the Star Wars Marvel comics. They are so good. I'm not a comic book guy. Like I've always been into comic book properties.
Yeah.
But the most of the I'm by no means like a comic connoisseur.
Mm-hmm.
But they are very, very good. the Vader. I read the Vader one in its entirety, the Lando one in its entirety, which was really short. And then I'm almost done with like the mainline Star Wars one that happens between A New Hope and Empire.
I really want to get in the comics. I really do, because they're so interesting.
I don't ever want to get
into it. I never know where to start.
I don't ever want to get, and that's what's nice about the Star Wars Marvel ones. It's like 2 years.
Everything.
Yeah, it's like 2 years old now. Yep. So you could read, in the next week, you could read every Star Wars comic there is.
Yeah.
And be caught up on everything.
Because I love the Avengers storylines and all that stuff. But
how many versions of the Avengers are there?
Which version
are
you going to start with? Yeah. Which one's better than the other one? And if you start here, do you have to read the individual characters' storylines to understand what's going on in the main one? Like, it's just, it's a rabbit hole you can never get.
That
through.
Part is common in everything, right?
Yeah.
So I read the Vader one, and then there's a sub part of that called Vader Down. And one of those is in, and they take place between different comic stories, unfortunately.
Yeah, so spoiler.
But that's one thing.
Spoiler alert, is that the one where he uses the stormtroopers as a shield? I saw like a clip on Facebook.
I don't remember that panel.
Okay.
It's the one where the thing that I feel like I showed you a long time ago, where it was.
Oh, he's surrounded.
Yeah, we have you surrounded. He's like, oh, I'm surrounded by his fear and dead men, and then just like wrecks face. So that is like the sub. It's like a six issue sub thing called Vader Down, and that is, if you wanted to start somewhere,
start there.
That's like a standalone thing that a couple things won't make a whole lot of sense, but like. You can pretty much understand everything that's going on.
Probably comic book fans will be annoyed with me, but do they have it like in App Store, Kindle Store, things like that?
I don't know.
Oh. Do you have read hard copy?
No.
Okay.
There are places where you can read them on the internet.
Oh.
Yes. Yeah. Wink. Wink. So my problem with, and this is my thing with comics, is I never got into hard copy comics because I feel like, as you can see, this is like the tiniest section of the things that I collect.
Yeah.
But I like collect things. And reading the comic degrades its value. Reading the comic can crease it. Reading the comic gets smudgy. You meet all this other stuff, right? So it's like, it felt like a chore to try and like read a comic and then keep it. Yeah, exactly. You feel like you have to be super delicate. Yeah. You have to like keep it in really good condition. Then you board it, you bag it and board it and then fucking put it away. And it's like, I'm not about that.
Yeah.
Because there are so many of them. Like, there will end up being thousands upon thousands of Star Wars comics at what is now, what, $3 an issue, roughly, when it's not the number one or an annual. And it's like, God, I don't have the money to do that, first of all. But second of all, it's like, it takes a lot of space. Yeah. It takes up a lot of time. You have to be really careful. And I'm like, no. So I just like scrolled through it on the computer, and that's so much better for me. So Brian got me into it. Brian showed me where to find them. And that was a much more enjoyable way for me to read comics, honestly.
All right. I'm good. I'll do it then. I'll have to.
Because I'd like to talk about it a little bit.
I will do my research.
They are, right now, they're like filling in interesting pieces of time.
Mm-hmm.
Like right after A New Hope to not quite Empire.
Yeah.
Like things that didn't really have a whole lot there. Or if they did in the old EU, it was like Splinter of the Mind's Eye, which is like the worst book.
It's going to be weird. So you said it's between New Hope and Return?
And Empire Strikes Back.
So it's really weird because, so you're going to, with the movies and the comics, you go from, you go from Rogue One, where he is a murderous, insane beast, destroyer of all, to New Hope, where he's a neutered puppy. Then the comics.
He's really not, though.
He is.
No, he's not. No, he's not. He force chokes someone from, like, across the galaxy.
Yeah, okay. Fair enough.
And then he fights his old. The only action you see him do in that whole movie that isn't, like, holding someone up by their throat or force choking them is fighting Obi-Wan. Yes, that is disappointing compared to today's whatever.
He's on a
but
leash,
it's also,
though. You know he's on a leash because...
Well, that's what's interesting is they go way into that in the whole Vader comic. And like it shows a lot of like relationship-y things or dynamic things, I guess, between him and the Emperor and other like high-ranking Imperial officers.
Okay.
And it's so... It's interesting to see how he handles that because he went from being like... The baddest guy ever to being like, don't fuck up again.
Yeah. Real quick.
Yeah.
real quick,
like really, really fast. And it's like it kind of like talks about that dynamic a lot, and it shows him in that.
That's
and it's
one
really,
thing I never
really
thought of is that the politics behind the Empire is very nuanced in the movies. Like yes. you're assuming it goes from Empire or the Emperor to like who's the top commander. It doesn't go directly to Tarkin. Like there's someone in between, but you never know who's between. It's not Darth Vader because he's not the one relaying those commands.
Right.
It seems like almost.
I think it was Tarkin.
Was it? Is he like
I think
the
by,
overall...
in A New Hope? I think it went Palpatine Tarkin because he was Grand. I don't know what a Grand Moff is.
Like that just sounds like.
But
the
there
Admiral.
Isn't. But there isn't another one.
Yeah, correct.
But there are admirals and captains gotcha. And generals.
It just seems like
But he's like the one that everyone's like, oh,
yeah.
Okay.
It seems like everyone's just kind of just floating around in space, be like, I'll chase this guy around.
Yeah, everyone's on their own.
Who's in charge of the government? It's an empire. Someone's in charge.
Palpatine. The emperor is in charge of the government.
Yeah, but
in theory,
Caesar still had people to relay his message.
This
it's
is
not
true.
Just Tarkin.
Well, I'm sure each one.
Space
well,
is infinite. There
it's
has
like
to be something.
It's
else.
Like well, that's where Rebels fills in a little yeah. bit of it, right? Because you end up seeing people like Agent Kallus and the people that he answers to, who are like more in charge of like a specific planet or a specific sector.
Yeah.
Which is interesting, also. Rebels is not the best show ever.
No.
But it does do some interesting things.
Finish watching it.
I just somehow I still knocked the camera, even though it's way over
there.
I'm
hitting everything too. I'm still trying
I
to
feel
get
like,
my bearings
yeah,
down.
Yeah, because we were sideways and we had a little more like wiggle room.
Yeah.
A little farther back. So now we're.
Well, I moved my hand. I just crushed my mic.
Yeah, we've all done that. I'm sure it'll be a little spiky and stuff, but it's fine.
So that was a long sidetrack. Sorry.
Sidetracked. Yeah.
So appreciate you guys listening. If you have any ideas, please share them.
We have a website now.
Oh yeah,
which we haven't talked about. So we'll be very quick because this is, I'm sure, getting right to the spot where it needs to be over. So we have a website. It is gotsidetracked.net because we're not millionaires, folks. I can't just buy that domain from someone because they wanted like thousands and thousands of dollars for it, for the .com. But there's a website. You can listen to this podcast. You can watch the YouTube videos that we have up.
And we're not going to stop with the YouTube videos.
No, we're just going to do that. We're going to do them less frequently, but they're going to be in between the podcasts and stuff. And you can submit ideas there. And we'll do newsy types of things there
so
as well.
If you have ideas, you can share them on Twitter.
Or Facebook, or you can go to
the website
and submit them there.
Or on YouTube at the bottom of this video if you're actually watching the video.
Yeah.
Which
it seems
to hear
like
what,
more people
yeah.
do than listen
yeah,
to it
sure.
through.
So we'd love to hear your ideas. We also have a third mic. So
ooh, we do. So we're going to start. It's not over there. I have it. It's right there. But it doesn't have anything for it
you
yet.
Can hold it.
Yeah, I don't have a...
That's fine.
I don't have a shock mount. I have to 3D print another shock mount for that one. And then we can have people on it.
Good thing we have these shock mounts.
I mean, I guarantee you. Look at how much this is shaking inside here. That's probably super helpful.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, anyway, so
sorry.
Give us ideas and we'll do we
them,
can introduce
maybe.
Them or introduce them to our show. Yeah.
Sure. See ya.
Take care, guys.